need to use a VRF named Corp. So in order to communicate with each other, right, you need to be able to ping from here to there. Now let's take a look at switch 10 here. When you first come up, check your interface. Next, we are going to talk about a practical question in the core written test of our CCIE EI 350401 address for an ENCOR. Okay? Show IP 15th question. Interface brief. Are there any interface address? So, this question can be considered as yes, there are. SVI interface VLAN 10.100.1.24. On switch 20%, it's the same. When you go to show IP interface brief, do you see interface addresses? Yes, 10.10 as the highlight 1.2 of the pool practical 20 part 4 in our entire yes. CCIE, then moving E on. Let's talk a written example of the gateways for. This is considered one of the more difficult two VLANs questions in our entire experimental test. So the main focus is actually on our GRE tunnel, and the not one is the gateway for VLAN 100. Our gateway is on R10's 10-0 with the address 10.100.1.1. From this side of switch 10, you need to ping the 0-0 port of our R10, which point of our VRF, our virtual routing table. So by doing this, when you come up, actually you need to first check the pre-configuration of our device. Let's talk about the key points you need to check in the pre-configuration to see if it can be pinged through. 10.100.1.1, can it be reached? Similarly, what is the gateway for our switch 20%? It is on Ether 0 of R20 with the address. Then log into the device with 1234. There are many key points to note in its pre-configuration. So the first step when you come up, then the ultimate goal, take a look first. Let's look at the third question, address being 10.101.2.1. See if you can ping it, right? 10.101.2.1, see if you can ping it. So from this segment, right? There are two small segments. It is actually for our switch 10, which has a VLAN 100 interface on it. On our switch 20%, there is an interface for VLAN 101. To communicate between VLAN 100 and 101, we need to use a VRF named Corp. So in order to communicate with each other, right, you need to be able to ping from here to there. When you go to show IP interface brief, do you see interface addresses? Yes. 10.101.2.24. Yes. Then, moving on, let's talk about the gateways for two VLANs. This switch, one is was not using the default routing method. It could also be anything, or it could be no IP routing. And then the default gateway goes there. It could be done like this, operated like this. In conclusion, when you gateway for VLAN 100, our gateway is on R10's 10-0-switch 0 to act with the address other web address 10 bytes. It should be able to send the 100.1.data1 packet to our gate from the gateway. Side of switch 10, you need to take a look at our the ping R10, the 0-0 and R20 port of our R10. Right? After coming up, you also need to check things because we have to see if it can be pinged through. 10.100.1.1, can it be reached? Similarly, what is the gateway for our switch 20%? It is on Ether 0 of R20, which explained it very clearly to the following students. So they need to configure such a tunnel interface, and it should belong to this VRF Corp. Simply put, this tunnel needs to be forwarded through the routing table of VRF Corp. So the router has a point called the port from the VRF, which can forward data traffic according to the VRF routing table only when it receives the address being 10.1. So the subsequent 0 tunnel in 1.2 interface must be configured .1 within the. See if you can ping it, right? 10.101.2.1. See if you can ping it. So from this segment, right? There are two small segments, VRF Corp context, in order to ensure that. Let's see if we can access them normally. Then, in the subsequent steps, to enable VLAN 100 on switch 10, to access the neighboring network, you need to check if there is a default route configured on our switch. Is it, right? So the next address is the gateway, on switch 20%. Is there a default route pointing there? Yes, of course, because this place was pre-configured by our teacher, with his own unique ideas. Maybe at that time, this switch was not using the default routing method. It could also be anything, or it could be no IP routing. And then the default gateway goes there. It could be done like this, operated like this. In conclusion, when you want our switch to access other websites, it should be able to send the data packet to our gateway. Let's take a look at our RE10 and RE20, right? After coming up, you also need to check things because we have explained it very clearly to the following students. So they need to configure such a tunnel interface, and it should belong to this VRF Corp. Simply put, this tunnel needs to be forwarded through the routing table of VRF Corp. So the router has a point called the port from the VRF, which can forward data traffic according to the VRF routing table only when it receives it. So the subsequent tunnel interface must be configured within the VRF Corp context in order to ensure that our switch 100 and switch 10's VRF 100 can access the neighboring data traffic later. When walking through this VRF routing table, you must ensure that the Ether 00 ports of our routers R10 and R20 are connected. Put it into our VRF, so you need to check this when you come up. When you run show VRF brief, you will be able to see if your ports have been placed into our VRF. You see 0-0 going in. The same goes for exchanging R20 on this side. The show VRF brief command has also been included in our VRF here. Once you have confirmed this point, if you find an issue with the port, if it's not placed inside the VRF, then you need to do it this way. You need to manually go into our port, manually put our port into the VRF. You need to go to show running config on port 0-0. If your port is not placed inside the VRF, you will need to manually configure it. However, one thing to note is that when you place the port into the VRF, just use IPVRF forwarding. But you need to pay attention. The way you assign ports into VRF is related to how you define this VRF. If your VRF is defined as pre-configured like we do here, if you define this VRF using the IPVRF method, then you just need to use EPVRF forwarding to put this port into the VRF. Another way is the definition method of this VRF. If the VRF on the other side is defined in a different way, using VRF definition, this way to define VRF, not in this way of IPVRF Corp. Then you need to pay attention, put the interface into the VRF command line. It's not configured as IPVRF forwarding like this, then what is it? It's called VRF forwarding, right? Just missing an IP, right? By using the VRF definition method, the defined VRF can support both our IPv4 and IPv6. So when you put the port into VRF, don't type in the IP, right? In conclusion, I have also written it very clearly on my end. When you type, you can directly use IPVRF forwarding. Or if you can't configure it, you can use this VRF forwarding method. The way we put the port into VRF is similar to the way we define VRF here. Related, next, let's talk about the configurations of R10 and R20. After checking this part, after these two short paragraphs, let's check the one above. The configuration of this GRE tunnel. So if the tunnel is to be established, we need to establish a tunnel between R10 and R20. You need to determine on our R10 and R20 on this physical Ethernet, can I access it? So the interface address of R10 is 10.10.1.1. This is our 0-1, 10.10.1.1. Then the Ether02 port of R20 is 10.10.2.1. First, you need to check if you can ping the other party. Please ping 10.10.2 to see if it can be pinged through. Can you still ping through? If it can be pinged successfully, so in this way, we can proceed to configure such a route. We have configured this tunnel interface. The underlying layer needs to communicate in order to establish a tunnel. if you want to set up a tunnel, you need to do this first. We need to do it this way. You need to create the tunnel interface first. During the exam, the tunnel entrance may have already been created. Just to allow students to practice more deeply, we directly deleted this tunnel entrance. If it is pre-configured, there is no tunnel entrance. You need to create it yourself. So you need to first interface loopback 0 through your tunnel entrance. And then, when it comes to our tunnel, we need to know where to start digging. Go dig over there. Then you need tunnel source, interface tunneling, feeling dizzy, sorry, tunneling, create tunnel interface, then tunnel source. Our Ether 0-1 port, start digging from your own 0-1. Take 10.10.1.1. We need to dig to get 10.10.2.1. Found the 0-2 port of R20. Tunnel destination 10.10.2.1. Dig over there. Then the tunnel has an address. We are in the GRE tunnel, right? So our own, when it comes to the address of our tunnel interface, the network segment is 10.100.100.0/24 subnet. So if we use R10, we can assign this address to it, IP address. For example, we are 10.100.100.1-24. We are 10.10.10.1.0.0.1.0.0.1. However, the question did not specify. Which address must we use for R10? So you can point freely. In short, this subnet will do. What else do we need to do? The question says we need this tunnel interface. It will be forwarded through the VRF of our corp. We need to put the tunnel interface into the VRF as usual. If your VRF is defined using the VRF definition method, direct VRF forwarding, and then if that's the case. When we define our VRF, if defined through IPVRF, you go directly to IPVRF forwarding corp, but you need to pay attention. Usually, we would like everyone to divide the VRF in a certain way. When we divide the VRF, we hope everyone will. First, assign the port to the VRF. Go to set the address again. During my demonstration here, I will first assign the address and then divide the VRF. In order for everyone to see this configuration error, you see it's the same inside our solution. Put the port into VRF first and then assign the address. The reason is simple. After putting the port into the VRF, the address of this port will be vanished. For example, if we were to go to the tunnel 0 port and do a show running config command right now. So there is an address, but as long as I put it into VRF, I go to AP VRF forwarding corp. The address is gone. Please go to show running config tunnel 0, put the port into the VRF, but the address is gone. So you need to pay attention to the order of this configuration. Do not find out that the address is configured in VRF when it is time to deploy. The result shows that ping is not successful. Then it's over. Configure the address, IP address, 10.100.100.1. 24 is enough. And of course, don't forget, there is another requirement for this question. Second question requirement. He said we need to use a pre-configured IPsec profile to encrypt our tunnel interface. So, during the exam, this second requirement, possibly not. We also mentioned on our end what might happen if this question appears during the exam. He knew that there was no requirement for tunnel encryption in the question, then you don't need to do the next step. However, if there is such a need, you are about to do, you go to show running config. You need to take a look at our IPsec profile. You can just take a look, just use the profile. Look around, we have an IPsec profile named My Profile. You need to use an IPsec policy like this to encrypt our tunnel. Then, tunnel protection, the IPsec profile is named My Profile. Add encryption to the tunnel. This is the configuration of our R20. Next, let's configure our R20. Similarly, on the R20 side, we do it this way. So let's create our tunnel interface, tunnel 0, tunnel source. we will start digging from R20's ether. 0-2, we need to dig to the other side. Discovered R10's ether 0-1 at. 10.10.1.1. And then, as for the tunnel, it belongs to our IP VRF forwarding, called Corp. Put it into the VRF, then provide an address. We are 10.100.100.2-24, done. Then we encrypt the tunnel, tunnel protection, APSEC profile. Call my profile. Why is it in uppercase? It's written like this, my profile, done. So the configuration is complete. Check if it is. Show running config interface tunnel 0. This is the tunnel 0 interface address of our R20. Its configuration. Also, let's check the show running config interface tunnel 0 on our R10. After completing this step, you need to check if our configuration is correct. You need to ping it. R20, please ping our tunnel interface. But you should pay attention. Our tunnel interface is inside our VRF. Then, you need to use our VRF routing table to ping the other side. You need to ping VRF Corp, our destination address, 10.100.100.2. Ping successful. So basically, our tunnel is fine. After completing this step, in fact, now we can connect the two tunnels together. But in order to ensure us, the data volume of VLAN 100 on your side is in the 10.101.0 network segment, able to access the neighboring 10.101.2.0 network segment. Then you still need to configure routing, show IP route. Let's not look at the global routing table, because we ultimately forward based on the VRF routing table. We need to view the VRF routing table. So you still don't have the routing entry on the other side. So you need to manually configure such a static route. Being able to access such a non-directly connected network segment across the way, you need to inform our R10 EP route. You need to insert it into the routing table of VRF Corp. I need to access a subnet of 10.101.2.0/24. Access the adjacent network segment. Throw that packet to our tunnel entrance. The next hop address of our tunnel. The tunnel entrance address for our R20. 10.100.1. 00.2. Throw it to our neighbor's place. Accessing another network segment. Throw it from our side to the opposite side of our tunnel entrance. Fly over there. Similarly, the same goes for R20 here. Similarly, so do show IP route VRF Corp, so there are no entries for single route. Then you need to insert an IP route VRF Corp 10 dot. So accessing the adjacent network is the 10.100.1.0 subnet. 10.100.1.0-20, 4 subnet, go to 10.100.10. 0.1, so it's done. After all configurations are completed, you need to check if we can ping successfully. From VLAN 100 on our switch, is it possible to ping to the neighboring VLAN 101 like this? Then you need to ping it. Then you go to ping 10.101.2.0. It should be 254 next door. If I remember correctly, 10.101.2.254. Able to ping successfully. So this question is completed. As for us below, there is no need to deal with any VRF, as long as we configure VRF on our R10 and R20 here. Just create a tunnel after completing this question. As long as it can be pinged, then the task is completed. But that's the same as before. Remember to save the configuration. You need to save the configuration of all devices to W2 after saving. We can move on to the next question directly. If you need to understand the core written test knowledge points of our CCIE, please get in touch with us students. Welcome to our Wolf Lab. So this question ends here. See you in the next question. Goodbye.